think I have to tell you how much fun this is for me. And I don't know if you know, but there's somewhat, a few of us wadded up on a corner out here and said some prayers a couple, 3 weeks ago, and somebody was watching. And then somebody else came and said a prayer, and somebody was listening. And I think probably the person who's been engineering all of this is Bishop Garrett, who built this building 100-plus years ago. This sweet little place has, teaches me, I think, one of the things that we worry about a lot is whether the church needs buildings or not anymore. You know, a lot of us have been thrown, and we need holy places. They may not need to be such high-maintenance places as we've turned them into, but we need holy places. And so I am more than happy to be here to say Mass in this building on the Sunday after Ascension. This is Ascension Church with you people. Now, if we had a casual observer come in, he might wonder what's going on, because this is the seventh Sunday after Easter, and yet it's also the Sunday that's called Ascension Day. And so let me do a little number on that. Ascension Day, you know, is always 40 days after Easter, so it's always a Thursday. And some time ago, they stopped enforcing the laws that said people had to go to church on high holy days. And so Ascension has suffered some. I don't know how many folks go to church on Ascension Day, but a big parish like Trinity in Fort Worth will be happy if they can get 20 folks. And I've done it with one or two a good many times. And I don't know how many of you greeted each other last Thursday by saying, "Happy Ascension Day." Probably don't hold all your hands up at once. But it's sort of like Transfiguration, which was always on August 6th, but that became identified with Hiroshima. And so now the church has moved it to the end of the Epiphany. And now then, this Sunday has sort of taken on the character of the Ascension. And the Roman church, where they do things from the top down, it's already called Ascension Sunday. We'll get there eventually. But I think it's, despite the confusion, it's important that we think about the Ascension, because the Ascension of Christ is one of the most difficult, I think, and also one of the most significant of the moments in the life of Christ. And so I want us to sort of deal with the Ascension in a couple of ways, and what it means and what it says to us. So first, we didn't get a long lesson today about the Ascension. Sometimes on Ascension Sunday you have a lesson which describes the Ascension. Today we just got it mentioned. If you noticed in the book of the Act, in the passage from Acts, it says, "From the time he went among us, from the baptism of John until the time he was taken up from us." And so, and if your memory's not entirely fresh, let's remember what happened. 40 days after his resurrection, Jesus was walking with some of the disciples along, and one of those clouds showed up. Now, the Bible is full of those clouds that just show up. And all of a sudden, there'll be a cloud show up, and somebody will get swooped off up into it, and wonderful things happen as a result. Those, now, in this part of the world, when a cloud kind of comes down from heaven, we run for the cellar. If you got any sense, you get underground. But in the Bible, it doesn't work that way. Sometimes those clouds just come along, and all sorts of astonishing things happen. And this happened to Jesus. They're walking along with the disciples, and the cloud comes down from heaven, and off he goes, just like that. Now, I don't know about you, but I'd be surprised if that happened. There are lots of paintings of this, and when you sort of look at the paintings of the Ascension, usually Jesus has kind of a sappy look on his face, like, yeah, he's going up into heaven like this. And the disciples are just sort of standing there like saying, "Well, look at there, he's doing it again." You know, he's one of those, I hate it when that happens. Just sort of not remarkable. You know, I think if it were me, I'd be knocked flat. That boy on television who walks on the water and so forth, people see him and makes things, you know, he's the magician. What's it called, the something effect? Anyway, people just go, ooh-ah. Well, no, they just are kind of going like this, just sort of like nothing had happened. But folks, you know, it's kind of a problem. Because most of us, I think, have abandoned the notion of a three-decker universe. Now, there may be some people here who believe in a three-decker universe, hell down below and us here on the flat, and heaven up top, and if you want to believe that, suits me, go right ahead. But I think most people don't. And so the question sort of arises, What happened to Jesus' body? Let me tell you a story. I've been in school an awful lot, and my daddy said that's what was wrong with me. And there were, back in the 70s, I was at the University of Dallas in a very high church program. We studied the fields of literature and politics at the same time. And there were only about 20 graduate students in the program, and there were at least that many teachers. And every once in a while, the great ones would call us to what they called a colloquium, which is actually was a time for us to have to dance on the hot skillet. Because what they would do, they'd bring a great one from afar, and he would make a presentation, and then we would all have to answer questions and comment on it. And this happened in an auditorium at the University of Dallas. It's one of those that's shaped like a hand, you know, the stage is down here, and then all the seats go back, one of those, that time. And all the teachers would get on the back pews up there and look down at us, and we'd be in the middle, all except for the president of the university, Dr. Donald Cowan. He didn't really run it, his wife did. She still lives, and don't tell her I said so because she'll come get me. But she was a good teacher, but we were all scared to death of her. And we had, the person who was called was from California somewhere, and his topic was, we were studying myth. And so his topic was the Ascension. And so we're all there, and Dr. Don is sitting way down front, and he comes in and kind of looks at us and he says, if on, let's say, April the 23rd of the year 33 AD, the body of Jesus had actually left the planet, headed for heaven, wherever that is, if you add it all up, what we know about the size of the universe, it wouldn't be there yet. And surely, with good telescopes, we probably, and that was before the Hubble, but with good, we could probably have spotted it by now. And then he looked at us kind of like, how about them apples? You know, he was really going to shock everybody. And a kind of a dark frost settled on the room, and we all kind of hunkered down. And Dr. Don Cowan turned around and looked back up, and he said, oh, how innocent. And it was just perfect, because the man had come at the whole thing the wrong way. That's not the way you think about this. It's not the way you think about this. How do we think about it? Because, after all, if we had the Hubble, fact is that something that leaving the surface of the planet, traveling at the speed of light, still wouldn't have reached the bounds of the known universe. So what happened to Jesus' body? What happened to it? The Romans could have, they had burned it. And the disciples swore that they had seen him alive. Every once in a while, you know, somebody comes up, you hear on the news that somebody's, they found the box that has Jesus' remains. And everybody gets excited about that, and the Baptist church throws a fit, and the Romans throw a fit, and everybody throws a fit, and then they find out that it's not really so. But the fact is, there are no relics of Jesus on the planet, no relics. Only two saints of which there are no relics, the Blessed Virgin and the Lord. Otherwise, they're relics, bones and teeth and toenails and stuff. Of course, all over Europe, there are little vials that claim to be the tears of Jesus or the tears of the Blessed Virgin. Probably if you joined them all together, they'd fill Lake Bridgeport. And sort of like all the relics of the Holy Cross, if you put them all together, it'd stretch from here to Bridgeport. I mean, there are no relics at all. So, what? It's a problem. What happened to the body of Jesus? What about this ascension where he just goes swooped off up into the heaven? What about all that? It's hard to believe. It's really hard to believe. Well, the people who are here from Wichita Falls, who are blessed friends, know that I'm sort of hooked on a writer named Robert Capon, a priest of this church who's been dead about 5 years now. The most freeing biblical scholar I know. And he says that every word of Holy Scripture is in there because the Holy Spirit wanted it there. And if there's a rock in the road, there's a rock in the road. And you can't deny it. You can't just sort of smooth it over. And trying to demythologize the ascension is really pretty difficult. It's one of those things that you're just faced with it. There it is. What you're going to do? And if you don't believe it, are you going to go to hell? If you do believe it, are you crazy? Was it mass hysteria that the disciples suffered? They gave their lives because they thought they'd seen that happen. They knew they'd seen that happen. So what do we do? I think this is one of those places in Holy Scripture where you pay your money and you take your choice. You can believe it literally, you can take it you can believe what you want to with it, but I think that the problem is we're grabbing it from the wrong end. And I want to give you a couple of suggestions about how to think about the Ascension and what it means for you and me now, today, in the Church of the Ascension in Decatur, Texas, in Wise County. If you're smart, before you leave here, you'll see this lady sitting in the back, and you'll give her your email address, and she will begin to send to you every week a copy of her, the parish bulletin from the Church of Wichita Falls called Joyful Notes. It is the best parish weekly in the church. The presiding bishop reads it, and when she doesn't get her copy, she sends a note and says, "Where's my joyful?" And I remember a few years back, she always chooses wonderful art for the first page cover art. And she had a wonderful icon of the Ascension. Now, Russian icons bother me a lot. They're kind of weird, you know, and the perspective is always backwards, and they're always looking a little this way and turning a little that way. They just look a little weird. And I kind of think, ooh, I don't know. But this one was rather astonishing. The disciples are standing down there going like this. And Jesus was up in the air, and his feet were apart. It looked like he was almost dancing in the air, almost dancing. And his hands were extended like this. And out at the edge of the icon, he was holding hands with somebody. He was holding hands with somebody. You couldn't see him because they got chopped off by the icon. My question is, who was he holding hands with? Before I tell you what I think, there's another Russian icon at Easter that I've seen that is just wonderful. Jesus is coming up out of hell where he had been, and it looks like a storm cellar door. I mean, it just looks just like a storm cellar. And he's coming up out of there, and he's got somebody with him. He's bringing somebody out. Who do you guess he's bringing out? Well, Adam, of course. His oldest brother. He's bringing Adam up with him. You know who I think Jesus is holding hands with in that icon of the Ascension? I think he's holding hands with you and me. I think he's holding hands with you and me. Let me talk about that for a minute. Let's think about the Ascension in two ways. First, mandate. And second, ending. Let's do the mandate part first. Jesus came to us to renew the old covenant. And the commandments that he gave, some of the commandments that he gave, were not new. I mean, what is the first commandment? Love the Lord with all you've got. And implied in that, and he makes it clear, is love your neighbor as yourself. And in case that wasn't specific enough, he adds, I want you to love each other the way I loved you. The way I loved you. In today's lesson from the high priestly prayer, he says, I am one with you, Father, and you are one with me, and I am one with them. And they are in the world, they're not of the world, but they're going to stay down there for a while. I want you to protect them with your love. I mean, the oneness that he leaves with us is a mystical thing. It's not something, it's something that you learn in prayer and in living. But he says, I'm leaving them there. I'm leaving them there. And wouldn't you think that during the 40 days that he was on the earth after the resurrection, before the Ascension, he had done some victory laps? You know, don't you think you've been interviewed by the papers and so forth, given all kinds of instructions and so forth to the disciples, got them really organized and ready to go? Well, you know, he didn't. There's hardly anything. All he eats with them a few times, visits with them a few times, reassures them. There's a story that when Jesus got to heaven, his daddy called him in, and here's the council of the angels, and they say, well, you seem like you finished the job. What did you leave? They said, well, I left 12 men there, and I told them, well, actually, there were 11, but you saw them replacing that one today in the first lesson. Said, that left 12 guys down there, and I told them to love each other. And he said, well, didn't you tell them who to be in charge and who to? No, that's, I just told them to love each other. Jesus came to the world to remind the world that God is not angry, that God indeed sent him into the world so that people might be saved. And he now has turned that work over to you and me. That's why we're holding hands with him there. He's still got a hold of us, but we're in the world, protected by the Holy Spirit and protected by the love that we have. But the work that he did, we are to continue. At this point, it's not surprising if somebody say, I can't save the world. Far be it. I'm just one person. And it's an easy way to sort of back out of the job. But on this, let's take a cue from Mother Teresa. When someone asked her, said, how in the name of God do you intend to take care of all the homeless people in Calcutta? There are more people that sleep on the streets in Calcutta than live in Fort Worth. And you know what she said? One at a time. Yeah. One at a time. Now, you and I can't save the whole world. Thank God we don't have to. But I think what Jesus is telling us when he turns it over to us, when he goes off, when he leaves us here with it and says, this is yours now, he's saying, I'm still working in the world. But maybe this one right now, who's walking up right now, maybe you need to take care of this one. I think what we're told is, we don't have to save the whole world, but we sure need to pay attention to the people God sends our way. And so one of the lessons from the Ascension, I think, part of the mandate is, we become more and more and more aware that the purpose of the church's existence is to be the light, to bear the light of Christ, and to show that love of God which was most perfectly revealed in Christ to the world, such as we are. No, you ain't perfect. No, if you're anything like me, you're a stinker. But for somebody, you may be the one chance to see the light of Christ. And so that's one thing I think we need to get from the Ascension. That's the mandate part. Now then, some of you know that I'm a school teacher. I'm an English teacher. You know, one of the worst class of people on the face of the earth. And I love literature, and I like to think of the Bible as literature, and I like to read it. And one of the things that's happening in the Ascension is, it's the end of the story. The story has to come to an end. It's the end of the story of Jesus's bodily life on the earth. And you know, things need to have an ending. Capon, my guy Capon says, the Bible is sort of like a movie. You got to stay till it's over. You may not like the whole thing. There may be moments in which you would say, I think we should leave. You know, no, wait for it to be over. Same thing if you know anything about music. You know that music is written in a certain key. And the composer can take that key and move off into another key and go into the minor, and he can do variations and he can change the key signature and so on and so forth. But, you know, you're all waiting for the heavy lady to sing, and when it's over and there's a kind of a sense, you can tell that it's coming because he'll be G, 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 C, you know, and you know it's over. It's a sense of an ending. You could also, well, think of Jesus's life maybe as a Western. It's just a story. There's a town where there's a problem. There's a bad guy in town, and there's a bad thing going on in town. And this guy rides in out of nowhere on a tall horse. And everybody says, oh, you can save us. And he says, that's what I came for. And so he cleans the town up, and he gets it all fixed up. And then when the story's over, of course, he marries the richest girl in town and becomes the mayor. No, he doesn't marry the richest girl in town and become the mayor. Everybody would hate him. He rides off into the sunset. That's what he does. And he leaves them. He said, I've shown you how to do it. Now you keep it up. One more, and then I'll quit. I don't know how many of you remember back in the first part of the... I love to look at old annuals, college annuals and high school books. I just love to look at my folks had some when I was a little kid at their college, and I had all that by memory. And very often you would see a picture of what's called a tableau vivant, a living picture, and they were very popular right after World War I. And what would happen at the graduation ceremony, when all the kids had to be on the stage doing something, or this family would be mad, they would have a scene where you have all of World War I sort of symbolized by the kids, and the rough little boys would be the bad Huns, and they would be down here with their guns and being terrible, and the little girls who weren't awfully pretty would be the, you know, Belgium being sacrificed and so forth, and then there would be somebody up here who were the American soldiers and the British soldiers, and then there would be a little girl who is France surviving, and there would be the evil Germany, and finally the prettiest little girl in school would be the Statue of Liberty wrapped in an American flag, standing up like this. And the way it worked is they'd have a spotlight, and they would show this part, and then they would show that part, and this part, and this part, and finally the whole, that's kind of like what the Bible is. The whole story is in there. It's just what's being shown up here. And so the Ascension is part of that, and this is where the Jesus part on earth comes to an end, kind of. Next Sunday is the Feast of Pentecost, the Feast of the Holy Spirit, the birthday of the church, in which we remind ourselves that we are protected because we have the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to do things we can't do, to do things that don't come naturally, to do things that we say, well, no, no, and then this thing is on our ear saying, yeah, because that thing that you don't want to do is the face of Jesus looking right at you and saying, in the judgment, will I know you? Will I know you? And so on this Ascension Sunday, in this splendid little place that we're bringing back to life with prayer, you can be thankful that Jesus rode into town on a tall horse and that he set things right and showed us what to do and left us with a silver bullet of the Holy Spirit. And that next Sunday, you can remind yourselves that even though it runs against my nature a lot of the time, I am empowered by the Holy Spirit to do those things which God does and to share in the work that he has left for us to do. So, happy Ascension Day. Amen.